flow into the house of the Lord. Anybody happy to be here? I said, is anybody happy to be here? Hallelujah. Come on, put those hands together. Hey.
The days of Elijah, preparing the word of the Lord. And these are the days of his servant Moses, righteousness being restored. And these are the days of your trial. The fields are white in the world. And we are the laborers in your vineyard, declaring the word of the Lord.
Behold, he comes riding on the cloud,
shining
like the sun.
At the trumpet,
calls,
you ought to lift your voice.
It's your voice.
It's the year
it's
to believe.
Out of Zion
to
salvation.
Behold, he comes.
On behalf of our Bishop S. Todd Townsend Sr. and Pastor Cleo Belina Townsend, we want to welcome you to our worship service. And this is not just a regular Friday. This is Good Friday. And we've come to celebrate the sacrifice of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. And I am excited to see all of you that are here in the sanctuary and all of you that are watching all over the world, because we are here to remember, to reflect, and to reverence the Lord. Hallelujah. And it lets us know in Isaiah chapter 53 that he was wounded for our transgressions. He was bruised for our iniquities. The chastisement of our peace was upon him, and by his stripes we are healed. And we have 7 dynamic speakers that are coming today. And guess what? They're our very own Resurrection Center ministers. And they are coming to stir your heart and to stir your spirit. So get ready to hear a word from God. And as it is our custom here at the Resurrection Center, we like to begin with prayer and praise. So join me as we pray. Hallelujah. Let us look to the Lord. Thank you, Jesus. We bless your name, God. We honor you. We worship you. Father, we come to you in the name of Jesus, the Lamb that takes away the sins of the whole world. Glory, honor, dominion, and power belongs to you. And we come into your presence this morning, this evening, God, with expectation, with thanksgiving. And we pray, God, that you will be pleased with everything that is done in your sight. Father God, we give you our heart. We give you our mind. We focus our attention and we draw nigh unto you. And we ask that you would enter into this place and that you will usher in your presence, your anointing, that you will touch each and every aspect of this service. Father, we have one desire, that we might give glory and honor to your name. So God, we thank you. thank you right now for how you are removing every distraction. We thank you right now for how you are causing us to go deeper in you. We thank you right now for how you are already blessed this atmosphere. We pray right now that you will compel the people to come. Compel the people to join in, God, that we might give you the glory and honor that you deserve. Father, we thank you in advance for what you've done already and what you're going to do. And it is in Jesus' name that we pray. Amen and amen.
Come on, put those hands together. If you know that there's nobody, no God like Jehovah, there's no God like Jehovah. Said
Once again, I want to thank you all for joining us tonight for our Good Friday service. Imagine with me that it is 9 a.m. on the morning that our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ was crucified. And there are many who have witnessed this gruesome event. But I'd like to quote the words of the songwriter Sandy Patty as she talked about his walk. Down the Via Dolorosa in Jerusalem that day, the soldiers tried to clear the narrow street. But the crowd pressed in to see the man condemned to die on Calvary. He was bleeding from a beating. There were bruises on his back. And he wore a crown of thorns upon his head. And he bore with every step the scorn of those that cried out for his death. Down the Via Dolorosa, called the Way of Suffering, like a lamb came the Messiah, Christ the King. He chose to walk that road for you and for me. Down the Via Dolorosa, all the way to Calvary. In Romans chapter 5, verse 8, Paul said he demonstrated his love for us, that while we were yet in sin, Christ died for us. It is said that most notable figures are remembered for the last words they speak before they die. And as Jesus hang on the cross these 6 excruciating hours, he musters up enough strength to utter out 7 statements that would resonate throughout the history of time. These 7 statements are known as the 7 last words of Jesus Christ, and they have had a profound impact on our lives. Let us prepare for the first word.
Good evening. First, I just want to take a little time just to give honor to God and to thank him for this opportunity to be able to stand in front of you. Thank him for this privilege. I also would like to take the time to thank the set gifts of this house, Bishop and Pastor Townsend, for their support and their prayers. And I also like a quick shout out to all the leaders here, my TRC family and my family and my friends. Pray with me as I bring the first word. Luke chapter 23, verses 32 through 34. Two other men, both criminals, were also led out with him to be executed. When they came to the place called the Skull, they crucified him there along with the criminals, one on his right and one on his left. Verse 34, Jesus said, "Father, forgive them, for they do not know what they are doing." And they divided up his clothes by casting lots. "Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do." I sat in silence for a beat. Enter a still small voice. Begin at the end. "Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do." For they know not what they do. He began at the end. Word made flesh news. God's way of life was greater. He could see, but they couldn't see. Called to be his, chosen by the Father to be, but consumed by earthly authority. They didn't understand his purpose in ministry, so how could they understand his purpose in death? "Crucify him! Crucify him! Let his blood be on us and our children! Give us Barabbas!" A man known for a murder and an insurrection. But before I let you feel comfortable with that was then, let me just remind you that January 6th was a thing. Now you're probably saying, "That was them, not me. Sin is so familiar, it's like the air you breathe. God says go, you say no, because you can only go as far as you can see. Limited choices begat limited vision. Self-righteous, the need to be right just propels us faster into the abysmal depths of sin. We all fall short, but my fall is more graceful than yours. All the while the blood from his side pours. Refusing to transform my stubbornness the norm. Illusions appeal, tick-tock, false evidence appearing real. Pass the hammer, if you please, lies leave lips with ease. Keeping eyes closed to see, ignorant. They were, we are, you are. I am still guilty. Nailed to the cross, erected like a rose out of stone, undaunted, he haunted the hearts and minds of all who watched. His life pouring out like water, all of his bones out of joint, struggling to breathe. Forgive them, my sweet Jesus would plead. Selfless love speak here at the end of things as it was in the beginning. Flashback on a hill just north of Galilee. God and love, a blood that redeems. You must be born of water and spirit to enter in. Dying for us, a life for a friend. The utterance of two words in the transformation of our lives were complete. Breathe. I stand in silence for a beat. I wonder how many of those faces were familiar. Betrayal squared plus ignorance divided by man did not equal justice. Mercy there was great and grace was free. No longer bound, we can never repay the debt of love we owe. Praising the Lord, he forgives us our debts, but like unmerciful servants, we have our debtors on auto pay. Forgiveness heals, forgiveness restores. Necessary if with him we want to be. Turn to your neighbor. Look at your neighbor. Say, he forgives you just like he forgives me. Breathe. Beat. Father, Abba, Daddy, calling out to the one he trusted, the one he loved, the one with all power and authority. So he laid all power aside and stepped into humility. Mocking ensued, the king of the Jews still he pursued, knowing who he was, allowed him to love us so perfectly. Salvation awaited, but the pathway was broken. He could see it from far away, from the cross to the grave to early on the third day, the truth, the life, the way. Lost sheep led back to our first love, the one whose image we were fearfully and wonderfully made. If you're ever broken, your world is smoking, and you're looking for a clue, remember the day your life was changed, remixed, rearranged, when Jesus said, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do.
Glory, glory, glory. Glory to our Father in heaven, who gave his only begotten Son for the remission of our sins. Glory to and holy to his name. Good evening, beloved. Good evening. And just like Deacon Pamela Jones said, I'd like to go ahead and to give honor to our set gifts, Bishop S. Todd Townsend and also Cleovelina Townsend. It is so good to see you back in the house of the Lord. Glory to God. So good to see you. All right. Beloved, my name is Michael Leon Miller, and I'm privileged to serve in ministry here at the Resurrection Center as part of the Levitical Order. And I am humbled to be able to give the second of the seven last words this evening. And the second of the seven last words can be found in the Gospel of Luke, chapter 23, verse 43. Again, I'm going to be reading from the New King James Version of the Bible. But again, this word is Luke chapter 23, verse 43. And it reads as follows. And Jesus said to him, "Assuredly, I say to you, today you will be with me in paradise." And Jesus said to him, "Assuredly, I say to you, today you will be with me in paradise." Beloved, I would like to lift up this evening a theological exposition in which I titled, "The Criminal, the Sinner, and the Savior." Amen. All right. Let me give a little context to this scripture here, which is going on. Jesus has been falsely accused, right? False charges brought forth by the Sadducees and the Pharisees. And they have said that Jesus is guilty of sedition and tax evasion. And he is brought before Pontius Pilate and also Herod Antipas. The thing is that neither Herod Antipas or Pontius Pilate find any guilt in Jesus. In fact, they find him innocent. And this is a problem, all right? Because the Jewish religious leaders are absolutely convinced and are set to have Jesus crucified. Right? And so in order to appease their bloodlust, Pontius Pilate has Jesus beaten horribly and whipped. But that doesn't satisfy their bloodlust. And so frustrated, Pontius Pilate finally gives up and says, "Look, it is the custom of the festival of the Passover," he says, "that I will give a reprieve, you know, to someone on death row and let's set them free. So you decide who you want to be set free, Jesus of Nazareth or Barabbas, a convicted criminal, thief, and murderer." And the people choose Barabbas. So now Pontius Pilate ain't got no other choice. He has got to sentence Jesus to death. But in doing so, he washes his hands and says, "This man's blood is on your hands because I find no guilt with him at all." So Jesus is led to the hill of Calvary, where he is crucified, nailed to the cross, a crown of thorns placed on his head. Two criminals, one on his right and one on his left, both are crucified at the same time. And while they are dying an excruciating death, the people begin to mock Jesus. And they begin to ridicule him and saying, "If you're the king of the Jews, get down from that cross." And one of the criminals actually chimes in and says, "Yeah, if you are the savior, why don't you save yourself and save us as well?" But there the other criminal says, "How dare you?" I'm paraphrasing here. "Don't you even fear God? This man has done no wrong. We deserve the sentence that we have received, but this man is innocent." And then he looks at Jesus and says, "Lord, when you come into your kingdom, please bring me with you." Again, I'm paraphrasing. And Jesus looks at him and says, "Assuredly, I say to you, today you will be with me in paradise." Glory to God. You see, beloved, Jesus being positioned between those two criminals is a perfect illustration of his purpose on earth, right? It is encapsulates his theological, missiological, and soteriological objectives in one viewing, in one event. I threw a lot of fancy words at you, but let me just go ahead and just make it real plain with 3 points, and then I'm going to get out of here. Theology, right, simply means knowing God. Beloved, you can't know God if you're separated from God. And all of humanity was separated from God because of sin, right? But Jesus allowed us to have that separation from God to cease and go away. Because all of humanity was locked up in the prison of sin and evil and wickedness. All of us undone some time, right? On death row, right? And also in solitary confinement called debauchery and decadence. But because of Jesus, God wrapped in flesh, Emmanuel, right? God with us, right? We now have an opportunity to get close to God because we never could when we was knee deep in sin. Hallelujah. All right. And so that was one of the areas in which he had to, in terms of theology of knowing God. The second point is mission. Jesus had several missions while he was here on earth. But one of the objectives was this: to reconcile an evil, wicked humanity back to God the Father. Right? Because we were separated from God, right? We had to, right, be able to be fully reconciled back to God. I read one time, I think it was Max Lucado who said this. He said that as soon as Adam and Eve partook of the fruit, the forbidden fruit, and disobeyed God, the shadow of the cross appeared in the Garden of Eden. Woo! Okay, and so now we've been fully reconciled back because of our disobedience of humanity, and now we could be in close relationship to God. Jesus taught us to pray this way. Our Father. Yeah. Our Father. Not my daddy. Our Father. All of us is a part of this, right? That close, intimate relationship, beloved, that term, Abba, Father, didn't even exist too much in the Old Testament. But it is replete in New Testament scripture. Woo! That is now the relationship we have with Almighty God. Final point, soteriological. It is a fancy word, but it means this. It's a Greek word that means soterion. That means salvation. We are all saved because of God, because all of us was on death row. On an HOV lane headed straight to hell. In eternity in hell, beloved. Okay, and so even we find here in Psalm 51:5, it says this. Indeed, I was guilty when I was born. I was sinful when my mother conceived me. All of us have that same sort of background, beloved. And so all of us are wrapped up in Barabbas. Because we all got a reprieve from the death sentence due to Jesus. Amen. So, in closing, let me say this. Again, I said that Jesus being positioned between those two, because two criminals, they both represent one faction of humanity, or two factions of humanity. The one criminal, clearly, in his thug life, right, saw Jesus and heard Jesus. In the power of hearing Jesus preach, let me tell you something. It's got to be something to hear the word from the word who in the beginning was with and is God. Because that criminal, right, once he heard the word, right, was convinced Jesus was the Messiah. And now this criminal who became a convict was convinced Jesus was the Messiah, and that led him to convert while he was on the cross. Because he asked Jesus to bring me into your paradise. Right? How powerful of a testimony is that? But then we have the other criminal who refused to admit that Jesus was the Savior of the world. And that criminal still is represented by billions of people on this earth who ridicule and mock Jesus as the Savior of the world. I'm so glad that Jesus called me, and I'm no longer in that particular position. Amen. Hallelujah. All y'all ought to be shouting about that. But let me leave you with just one point. That one criminal who got convicted and was convinced that Jesus was the Messiah, not only did he ask Jesus to bring him into his paradise and he got saved and converted on the cross, but he actually defended Jesus while he was being crucified. Because he told the other criminal, yo, man, shut your mouth. You don't have any idea what you're talking about. This man is the Savior of the world. This man has done no wrong. I'm trying to get you to understand this. While he was experiencing the same excruciating death as Jesus, he was defending him. What does that say about us? If this man could defend the honor of Jesus while being crucified, what is our excuse? Right? So I implore you, I exhort you, to continue to go boldly and to preach about our Lord and Savior Christ Jesus and the prospect of having an eternity with our Lord. Amen.
Good afternoon, saints. Good evening. I almost said good morning. Can we celebrate Deacon Pam and Minister Mike for those first two words? Well, they gave me 7 minutes, and the team asked me for a minute each. So we'll see how we do. Amen? So I have the third word. I have the third word, which is Mother, behold thy son. Brothers and sisters, we learn a lot about leadership, servitude, and sacrifice when we take a look back and truly digest what Jesus did for us in the fulfillment of the scriptures. We gather here on a Friday for the seven last words, just as a reminder of the sacrifice that was made. In the first word, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do, we find a sympathetic leader. In the second word, today shalt thou be with me in paradise, we find an encouraging leader. But this brings us to the third word, woman, behold thy son, found in John chapter 19, verse 26. But then if we continue to John verse 27, we find that Jesus says to the disciple John, behold your mother. And the Bible says from that hour, the disciple took her to his own home. In the third word, we find ourselves witnessing a discerning leader. For the next few minutes, I'd like to unpack the essence of those four words. Woman, behold thy son. And if I had to give this synopsis a title, it would be A Void Fulfilled. One of our objectives here at the Resurrection Center has been to inject a spirit of generational generosity in the fellowship. Not only in the fellowship, but also in the church, in our homes, in our families, and in the communities that we serve day in and day out. Generational generosity is when we ensure that anticipated voids will be forever fulfilled. Generational generosity is when we ensure that anticipated voids will be forever fulfilled. A void fulfilled. I would like to underscore that a heart to be generous, an appetite for generosity, requires a willingness or a desire to fill voids. To fill a void simply means to see to it that emptiness doesn't exist where fullness is supposed to take up refuge. To fill a void simply means to see to it that emptiness doesn't exist where fullness is supposed to take up refuge. If you're thirsty, you get something to drink. If you're hungry, you get something to eat. If you're in need of a word from God, you come to church or you seek the scriptures for yourself through prayer and devotion. To fill a void simply means to see to it that emptiness doesn't exist where fullness is supposed to take up refuge. The point here is that when Jesus glanced, he discerned that Mary, his mom, and John, his boy, were destined to have a void in their hearts that needed to be fulfilled. Jesus, my brothers and sisters, is in the business of fulfilling voids. The question is, how do we get to this moment where Jesus is so in tune with the earthly realm while also being connected to the spiritual realm? What did Jesus experience that led him to believe that he must take action in the lives of both Mary and John in order to fill a void that his fulfillment of the scriptures would leave in their hearts? Jesus had been captured, he had been beaten, he had been mocked, he had carried the cross, he had been nailed to the cross, and at some point, despite all the affliction, Jesus has a presence of mind to consider his mother and to consider his boy John. Woman, behold thy son. John, behold your mother. What is in Jesus' memory bank that causes him to be such a discerning leader? You all remember back in Luke chapter 2 when Jesus' mother and father took him to a dinner. They lost track of Jesus for a few days. Jesus was in the temple. He was teaching, but he was listening too. He was teaching, but he was listening as well. Jesus understood the balance of not only teaching, but also intaking and listening at the same time. But if you remember when his mom and dad came and they found him, they had anxious. They were anxious. And they said, why have you done this to us? And Jesus, I'm paraphrasing, said, Can't you see that I had to be about my Father's business? I personally want to suggest to you that on the cross, Jesus dug back into his memory bank and he remembered that moment. He remembered that moment, which allowed him to discern that his mom, as well as John, were going to have an empty void as he went on to fulfill the scriptures. And his parting words to them both were, "Mother, behold thy son." And he said to John, "Behold your mother." And with those four words, we have a void fulfilled. Amen.
Amen. Amen, amen, amen. Come on, it's a Good Friday in here. Oh, come on, y'all can do better than that. It's just a good day to have a good day, huh? Is anybody else happy about a Good Friday? Come on, we need to get excited about it. Glory be to God. Come on, don't look at me. Get excited. It's a Good Friday. It's just a good day to have a good day. Amen. Amen. I bless God for our bishop is in the house and our pastor. We thank God for our shepherds. Amen. Amen. We bless God for them. And I thank God for Deacon Pam and Minister Mike and Pastor Larry bringing forth that word. And so I'm Elder Carmen. For those who don't know me, I'm bringing forth the fourth word. And I will be reading in your hearing this evening, Mark 15, verses 33 through 34. And the word of the Lord says this. It says, "Now when the sixth hour had come, there was a darkness over all the land until the ninth hour. And at the ninth hour, Jesus cried with a loud voice, saying, Eli, Eli, lama sabachthani, which is translated, my God, why hast thou forsaken me?" If I had to tag a title to the text this evening, I would say forsaken but not forgotten. Come on here. Come on here. Has anybody else in the audience felt like you've been forsaken, isolated, forgotten? The Lord sent me in here with a download this evening to remind you that even when you feel forsaken, you're never forgotten. So here we have Jesus' arrest and his trial begins in the early morning hours of Good Friday. It was on this day that he faced Pontius Pilate, Herod, and the crowd demanding his crucifixion. The betrayal of Peter and the abandonment of his followers. He was mistreated, he was beaten, and eventually crucified in our place. Is anybody out here happy that he took your place? So there's three things that the Lord revealed to me about Jesus' journey to the cross that is relative to his crucifixion. The first thing that the Lord revealed to me, he reveals that Jesus is in a moment of testing. Here, Jesus is in a dark place in his journey where he feels abandoned, forsaken, and forgotten. Has anyone ever been in a dark place where you just feel like you've been abandoned, forsaken, and forgotten? That's that moment of isolation. Come on here. Everybody should have said amen, because 2020, COVID didn't prophesy that in advance. That was our moment of a dark place. But he never left us. Millions of people died. He never forsake us. We still made a way where he provided. He never left us. You never ran out. Come on here. He never runs out of supply. We serve a God that never runs out of supply. Amen. So here is where Jesus is in a moment of testing. He's in a dark place in his life. It's the sixth hour, and he feels like God still hasn't shown up. I done prayed and prayed and prayed about the same thing, and I still feel like he hasn't shown up. Have you ever felt like God has not shown up? But I came in here to tell you sometimes he shows up in a different form, just not the way that you thought he was going to show up. I just heard the Lord tell me to tell you, look again. Look again. It didn't show up in the form and the fashion that you thought it was going to show up in. Look again. The second thing the Lord reveals is that Jesus is in the middle of a transition. So not only is he in the middle of a testing, in a moment of testing, he's in the middle of a transition. Jesus is at a moment in his life when he realizes that the journey was not just about performing miracles. It's that moment when you realize that this is the part of the mission that includes your crucifixion. It's not just about the miracle. He's in the middle of a transition on his way to the resurrection. That's something we can get happy about. Hallelujah. Come on here. It's a moment of testing. I'm in the middle of a transition. I'm going through a crucifixion, but I can get excited about the resurrection. Come on, talk back to me. I ain't gonna get a whole lot of amens, but you gotta learn how to get excited in advance. Hallelujah. It's that moment, Pastor Cleo. It's that moment when we're in between his prophecy and his promise. Come on. Talk back to your girl. Holla at me. It's the moment when you're between the prophecy and the promise. It's when you're no longer, it's the no longer, but the not yet. Come on, that went right over your head. It's the moment when it's the no longer, but the not yet. But you're in transition. You're still waiting. You're still believing. You're still praying. You're still fasting. It's that moment when you're going, when what you're going through looks nothing like what God showed you. He'll give you a revelation in the dispensation of timing that you're in. It's all about his timing. And so like Jesus, we're in a moment of testing. We're in the middle of a transition. And the third thing that God reveals is that Jesus has endured the mocking of his tribulation. Because if you read down a little further, I just read 33 through 34, but in 35... they're mocking him. When he cries out to God and says, you know, they say, well, he must be calling on Elijah. Because he said, Eli, Eli, lama sabachthani. They thought he was calling on Elijah. They were mocking him, right? So he's enduring the mocking of his tribulation. And so like Jesus, we are in a moment of testing in the middle of a transition. We must remain watchful of people who only support during our miracle season, yet mock you in your tribulation. See, the Bible said they disappeared, Dr. Connolly. See, it's all good when I got it going on. But when I have nothing left and all I have to offer you is God's best, come on, talk back to me. Where are you? Come on. I'm in my closing. I'm getting ready to close. I just said a whole mouthful right there. So I'm really careful. That's one of the things that you learn in the maturity of Christ. That's something you learn in your walk. To be careful of people who always support you during your miracle season, but you can't find them or they're mocking you in the midst of your tribulation. So in closing, and just like the journey of Jesus, the life of Christ, there are times when you feel forsaken, but not forgotten. Cast down, but not conquered. Discouraged, but I'm never dismayed. But here's the good news. That in spite of what it looks like, they didn't expect them to get up again, but in spite of what it looks like, this is the good news. That no matter what you're going through, he promises to never leave you, nor forsake you. And we have to remember, people of God, when we're feeling forsaken and we're feeling forgotten, there's a fortitude that gives us an attitude of gratitude, knowing that I had to go through all of this. Because when I come up off this cross, you better believe I'm coming off with power. I'm going to say that one more time for the people in the back. When I come up out of this, look at your neighbor. Make that thing personal. Come on, Pastor Cleo. We got a right to praise them. Come on, somebody. I got a reason to praise them. Look at your neighbor. Tell them, when I come up off this cross, I'm coming out with power. So never despise what you're going through. And I'm going to leave you with this. Get ready, get ready, get ready, get ready for Resurrection Sunday. It's that moment when you're reminded that because he rose again, in the end, we still win. God bless you.
How's everybody doing this evening? Amen. I greet you from Life in the Word, and I want to give honor to the angels of this house, Bishop and Pastor, and to Elder for inviting the liturgical dance ministry. I will be reading for your hearing Hebrews 9, 11 through 12. When Christ came as high priest of the good things that are already here, he went through the greater and the most perfect tabernacle that a man made, that is to say, not a part of this creation. He did not enter by means of blood, goat or calf, but he entered the most holy place once for all by his own blood, having obtained eternal damnation. For Christ did not enter a man-made sanctuary that was only a copy of a true one. He entered heaven itself, now to appear for us in God's presence. Amen.
Glory to the Lamb, glory to the Lamb, glory to the Lamb, glory to the Lamb. Everybody say,
glory to the Lamb.
We sing
glory, glory to the Lamb.
We give all glory
to the Lamb.
Yes, we sing
glory,
glory to the Lamb.
To the Lamb.
This is why. For he is
Alpha
and Omega,
Omega.
Forever is he. And he will reign forever. Holy, holy.
holy, holy, holy is he. So together let's sing glory,
glory
to the Lamb. Father, we sing tonight, glory,
glory,
glory to the Lamb. We give all the glory,
to the Lamb.
Jesus is his name. We give
glory,
glory to the Lamb. For he is
now.
He's the beginning.
Okay.
And he is the end.
Forever,
forever he will reign. And he will reign forever. With all power and authority.
Forever,
forever he is king.
Oh.
Holy is he.
Is.
Holy is he. So we sing glory,
glory
to the Lamb. We give all glory,
glory
to the Lamb. We declare to all creation glory. It goes to the Lamb. We declare in the heavenly places glory to the Lamb. Come on, church. We sing glory to the Lamb. Cause nobody's greater. Nobody's bigger. Glory to the Lamb. You are all the worthy. You are all the worthy. Glory to the Lamb. There's no one like you in all the earth. We give it to Jesus. We sing glory to the Lamb. Strength is rising as we sing. Just and true are your words, Lord God Almighty. Who will not fear you, O Lord, and bring glory to your name? You alone are holy, and all nations will come and worship before you. Saints and angels sing. The saints and angels sing. Glory to the Lamb. We sing glory
to the Lamb.
For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. One more time. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever.
Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Now listen, Linda's getting ready to give a word, but just before she does, I want you to understand, when you watch, yes, yes, come up front, come up front, come up front. Where the Spirit listeth, the Spirit of God, where the Spirit of God, right here. No man knows where the wind blows. The wind comes and the wind goes. And God blows His Spirit in your life, around your life. The Spirit of God at work, morning, noon, and evening. No man knows where the Spirit comes from or where it is going. But we are born of the Spirit of the living God. Hallelujah! Hallelujah! Hallelujah!
Hallelujah, for thine is the kingdom,
and the glory,
and the power, and the glory forever. We sing.
In the name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. My name is Miss Linda. And I want to say thank you, Pastor Tamika, for the invite. And Bishop and Pastor, thank you again for sharing this sacred space. In an old Baptist tradition, I do need to say thank you to a few folks. to my rock, my R-O-C, who is my earthly R-O-C-K. I love you, honey. And to the joys of my life, Jay, Mika, Lauren, and the Grands, thank you. And to my family, for all your love and support all my life. And to my bestie who's out of town and my ride or die, too numerous to name, you know who you are. And to the countless others who have poured into me for such a time as this, I'm grateful. Father, I cannot speak unless you touch my mouth. I am a woman of unclean lips, and I dwell amongst the people of the same. But if you touch my mouth, here I stand. Here am I. Use me. Father, use me. Bible records this in John 19 and 28. Later, knowing that everything had now been finished, and so that scripture would be fulfilled, Jesus said, I am thirsty. I'll read it again. Later, knowing that everything had now been finished, and so that scripture would be fulfilled, Jesus said, I am thirsty. He is thirsty. He is thirsty. He is thirsty. Jesus is thirsty. Hold up. Wait a minute. Here's this man, fully human, fully divine, been baptized in water, who turned water into wine, who calmed the water, who walked on water, who commanded others to walk on water, paid his taxes with a coin from a fish in the water, and peeped this, told girlfriend at the well, if you had known the gift of God and who it was that said to thee, thou would have asked of him, give me drink, and he would give it unto me. This is the way the contemporary psalmist phrased it. Jesus explained, he is living water, yet he is thirsty. He escaped death as a child, living, some say, hiding in the hood. As a young lad, done left his parents for a few days, hanging out in the synagogue, teaching grown folk. Walked all over this land, healing every kind of disease and sickness among the people. He even touched a coffin, and the boy inside came alive. Folk been told by God in heaven, this is my son whom I love. With him I am well pleased. He was transfigured, clothes pure white and face shining like the sun on a high mountain. Living water is now thirsty. But wait, there's more. Demons been doused, you know, extinguished. They came out and went into the pigs, and the whole herd rushed down the steep bank into the lake and died in the water. He spoke and drove out demons for many people with just a word. Once he rebuked a demon right out of a boy. You know, that time when the unbelieving disciples pissed him off. Another time Jesus spoke and told demons, shut up and come out. And those demons obeyed. In the wilderness, being tempted for 40 days and 40 nights, told Satan, talk to the hand. And Bible records afterwards, he was hungry, but no mention of thirst. But it doesn't stop there. Tables been turned over, not once, but twice. I didn't make this up, y'all. It's in Bible. And I learned it on Tuesday nights in Bible study. Come on out. He knew what folk were thinking and what they were going to say before they did. Virtue came out of him when faith touched just the hem of his garment. He cleared the room of laughing folks and proceeded to wake up a dead girl. He bent down, wrote in the dirt, and everybody done scattered. Fed the multitude on several occasions that we know of with just some bread and fish, no hot sauce. Even put his finger in a man's ear, spit, touched his tongue, man no longer deaf, no longer dumb. How is living water now thirsty? Fully human, fully divine. He told, dude, you ain't taking jack. You have no power over me. I'm laying it down freely. Denied by his boy once, no twice, no three times. And Jesus looked right at him the third time. Tight with this dude for 3 years. Surely this should have left a sour taste in his mouth. And at some point, all his boys deserted him and fled. One ran right out of his clothes. Some of the theologians debate that that might have been John, the disciple whom he loved. Closer to the days of his crucifixion, his soul was overwhelmed with sorrow to the point of death. And ultimately, he asked the Father to take the cup. And right before they hung him on the cross, Jesus was offered drink, but he refused. Now he is thirsty. Reading this and studying this and meditating on this, I became a bit perplexed. Some might say baffled or a bit puzzled. Jesus is living water, and Jesus is thirsty. Now, I know what some of y'all might be thinking. I can see it in your face. I thought it too. He's on the cross. He's been bound. He's been dragged. He's been beaten. He's been ridiculed. He's been accused. He's been lied on. He's been insulted. He's been spat on. He's been screamed at. He's been slapped and punched in the face. He's been flogged. He's been interrogated. He's been stripped. He's been blindfolded and taunted. He's been mocked. He's been sneered at, beat in the head repeatedly, forsaken by man and God. Who wouldn't be thirsty? Who wouldn't be thirsty? Then I got it, y'all. I got it. It hit me. It hit me, Bishop. Flesh and blood didn't remind me of this. I got it. Living water is thirsty. I am is thirsty. He is thirsty so that we, you, and me would never be. Shalom.
I got a man inside of me. I feel the need.
I feel the need.
Oh my, oh my.
God in the mountains, oh. Lord in Jacob's well,
but somehow
there goes a well, springing up living water, worship in me. I will never touch again.
Everlasting.
Amen. Good. Greetings this evening, family. First, I want to say thank you to Pastor Tamika for the invite to be standing here. What a blessing. And also to our secus, Bishop and Pastor, I thank you for, as Miss Linda said, sharing this space. So I am Deacon Tracy Greer, coming to you this evening with the sixth word of Jesus, found in John 19, verse 30, reading from the New King James. So when Jesus had received the sour wine, he said, "It is finished." And bowing his head, he gave up his spirit. Tetelestai, it is finished. These three words of Jesus translates into this one word that comes from the Greek, which meant the completion of a transaction, debt, or an assignment. Whatever the agreement was had now been accomplished, or in the realm of merchants or accounting, paid in full. It was a happy time or occasion to use this word because it meant that something had been completed successfully. Jesus didn't say, "I am finished." We know he was just getting started. He said, "It is finished." This was not the relief of a dying man, nor the concession of a defeated man, but the triumphant words of victory of an accomplished mission. So what was finished? What exactly was paid for? At the core, the issue of the cross involves the addressing of the problem of sin. Mankind, based on sin, had incurred a debt we were unable to pay. Anybody here ever had some debt you've been unable to pay? Man alone owed this debt. It was our bill. We owned it. And we didn't have what it took to pick up this tab. Only God, the one who is perfect, could pay this. Something had to address the debt of sin incurred by man.
Why did Jesus have to say it is finished? Well, because up until he died on the cross, it was not. Imagine you have a credit card, and we all do. Every time you sin, the card gets charged. You can imagine that that card gets charged up pretty quickly. When the payment becomes due, the balance is so high, you can't pay it. You can beg, borrow, and steal, but you can't pay it off because you keep right on sinning and the charges keep right on growing. Well, you're not alone because the people to the left of you, the people to the right of you, the people sitting behind you, and the people sitting in front of you are right there with you. Every time we sin, the charges keep racking up. And oh, by the way, payment can't be paid in cash. It must be paid in blood. Sin produced a debt so great. While man alone owns the debt, only God can pay it. Only he has enough to pick up the charge. So God looked at our bill, said, "You can't pay this. Therefore, I'm going to pay it. How I'll do it is, I'm going to become like you, but still be me." On the cross, what we have in Jesus Christ was the perfect sacrifice. He lived for 33 years perfectly. Never did he act or do anything unacceptable to the Father. "And he who sent me is with me. The Father has not left me alone, for I always do those things that please him." He had no debt himself. He was sinless. Fully God, for God was his Father, and fully human, for Mary was his mother. Able to die as man, but had the perfection of God. "For God so loved the world, he gave his only begotten," which means one of a kind, "Son." He died for one purpose, to do the work the Father had given him to complete. For Jesus was born to die. The accomplishment of his death was the purpose of his life. "For he made him who knew no sin to be sin for us, that we might become the righteousness of God in him." He became the substitute for the sins of all men, each and every person, even those of us yet to be. Tetelestai, it is finished. By using these three words, Jesus was saying, death will be destroyed, the power of sin will be destroyed, the penalty of sin will be destroyed because of the sacrifice he's made on the cross. He died once for all. Jesus' sacrifice was enough. We can't add anything to it. No amount of prayers, your good works, monetary giving will suffice. We can't pay our way back into right standing and wipe out our sins. His sacrifice was the pure and perfected love of God. So on the cross, God took the penalty so he could still love the sinner while paying for the sin, in order to satisfy his wrath by expressing his love without compromising his perfection. God has called every one of us to finish this life well, being confident of this very thing, that he who has begun a good work in you will complete it until the day of Jesus Christ. What God starts, he finishes. That's a great encouragement for all of us to know that he's going to complete the work that he started in each of us. He's never going to give up on us. This might be hard for us to fathom because we don't stick to our own words, nor do we stick to our promises for lack of discipline and commitment. But hallelujah, that we had Jesus who did. He himself bore our sins in his body on the cross that we might die to sin and live to righteousness. Jesus stayed the course, even when he was abused, rejected, lied on, beaten, tortured, and in unimaginable agony. Tetelestai, the counsel and commandment of his father concerning his sufferings had been fulfilled. Soul and body, his pain was over. Every moment Jesus hung there on that cross with love, the love he has for each and every one of us. As he was dying on the cross, his words broke through time and space. Even now, 2,000 years later, we don't have to work to get to God. Jesus paid it all, and his sacrifice paves the way for us even today. He lived a life that we couldn't live, and he died a death that we deserved in order that we might have eternal life. God reached out his arms to us saying, I love you this much. The holiness of God and the mercy of God intersecting in the person of Jesus. Three nails and three words settled all sin for all of us. Forever, always, day and night, all the time, the entire time, everlasting, permanently, eternally. It is finished.
Praise the Lord, saints. Oh, come on now. That's good for me, but that's not good for him. Praise the Lord, saints. This is a great Friday. Amen. And so listen, I have the honor and the privilege to come and to share the final word, the seventh saying of Jesus from the cross. Amen. And so as we prepare to do that, I just want to be very clear about what I'm really here and what I'm really intending to do. We've already been fed, right? Come on now, we've already been fed. I just came to stir the pot. Hallelujah! I just came to stir the pot a little bit. So listen, giving honor to the set gifts of this house, our own bishop and Pastor Townsend, hallelujah. We are glad to see you here this evening. God bless you. To the one that makes my heart go boom, boom. To my own loving, wonderful husband, Brother Dale. And so I won't say too much because then y'all see him start blushing. But that's okay. Because he can't really handle that in public so well. But that's all right. Praise God. Praise God. I'm excited to be here with you all tonight. And again, as I said before, we've come merely to stir the pot. Amen. Let's pray. Our Father, our God, it is in the matchless name of Jesus that we come to you today. This evening, in this hour, in this very moment, God, that we come to bless your name, to say thank you, and to bow and to reverence you for all that you have done. How you came and you rescued us from where we were to bring us to where we are. That is the knowledge and understanding of you. And we give your name glory, and we do it with thanksgiving in our heart. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen, amen. So listen, saints, I want to say this. Miss Linda mentioned this briefly. She slid it in, and I hope y'all caught it. She mentioned being at Bible study, amen, on Tuesday evening. So I'm going to up her one if I can do that. And that is, I would love to hear you on the prayer line Monday through Friday at 6 a.m. and 6 p.m. because there's a word from all of these wonderful people that you've heard share tonight and many more that come and offer devotion and prayer. And just come, whether you want to pray aloud or you just want your spirit to be washed in the prayers that are going forward, come and be at the pool with us. Amen. Amen. So listen, that's all we're going to say about that. That's all I got in terms of commercial. Let's get into the word of God. In the book of Luke at chapter 23, we find the last saying of Christ. I'm going to share with you verses 44 through 46, and it reads this way. It says, it was now about noon, and darkness came over the whole land until 3 in the afternoon because of an eclipse of the sun. Then the veil of the temple was torn down the middle. Jesus cried out with a loud voice, saying, Father, into your hands I commend my spirit. And when he had said this, he breathed his last. Father, into your hands I commend my spirit. And when he had said this, he breathed his last. Now, I don't know about any of you all, but you know, I'm sort of living in that space of life where my grandparents used to tell me, you don't have to worry about figuring it out right now. Just keep living. You'll see it. You'll get there. It'll begin to make some sense to you. You'll come to, you know, those hard places in life, those sand pits and those hurdles and, you know, and all the like, those things that cause you to trip up and cause you to get dry in your mouth, right? So I'm living in that place right now. And why is that important to say? Because when we opened up reading at Luke chapter 23 at verse 44, it's very specific that it was noonday. Now, at noonday, the sun is high. Like, where my people come from down the south, the farmers, they call that, it's the sun is high. There's something going on that it is jet black at high noon. There's a situation. Something is happening. Sis, there's a shift. There's a shift taking place. And so I want you to understand that there are times as we are living our lives and we are bouncing around in the heat and the warmth and the beauty of the noonday sun, we're living our best life. And all of a sudden, life comes through and eclipses our sun. But that's only because God is at work. Amen. And so here we are. And after so much has been said, we've heard so much has been said, we find Jesus. And we find Jesus disgraced, we find him brutalized, we find him ambushed, and barely clinging to life on the very trees that his father spoke into existence. I mean, what sense does that make? He's hanging on the tree that his father spoke into existence, his father created, and he's hanging on the tree at his father's request. None of this makes any sense. Jesus has already addressed our forgiveness, right? He's already addressed our salvation, right? He has already addressed relationships and willing the care of his mother, Mary, to John, the one that he loved. And we've heard his sense of abandonment when he asked about, why have you forsaken me? He cries out in distress, seeking relief in his most vulnerable moment. And it's met with mockery. We've even heard his words of triumph, declaring that it is finished. And finally, yes, finally, we come to his word of reunion, where he says to his father, Father, into your hands I commend my spirit. Understand this. As Jesus hangs on the cross, his voice is growing weaker, even as his resolve for finishing the work that he said to do grows stronger. And so why is that important? I'm glad you asked. Because when he first begins speaking, he is talking to and he is ministering to and on the behalf of the people surrounding him. But not only those who are at the foot of the cross, those who have mocked him through time, those who wouldn't accept, those who wouldn't believe, those who would not bow down and honor his Father. He's talking and doing this work for all of them, for all of us. But by the time he comes to his last recorded statement, it's about his relationship with the Father. It's simply that Jesus is making a decision to put the essence of who he is into his own Father's hand. No matter what Jesus has endured, no matter how many disappointments he's dealt with, no matter how many times they tried to discredit him and the very miracles that they benefited from, no matter how many times the people were trying to taint his Father's house. Now, again, I don't know about y'all, but pretty much when people come to my parents' house, I become very protective, right? I'm glad there's somebody else in the room. I become very protective, and I take on that role, and I'm the person that's saying, no, we're not going to tear that up. No, we're not going to be in here disrupting the atmosphere. No, we're not going to destroy the integrity of the home. Nope, we're not doing none of that. Not in here. You got to take that outside. We're going to leave it the way we found it. That's what we're going to do. We're going to leave this just the way we found it. And this was Jesus' statement when he was angered in the temple about how his Father's house was being treated. But I do not want to digress. So the last words of Jesus from the cross shore up his relationship with the Father. Jesus intentionally wills his spirit into the Father's hand, knowing that if he is in him, hidden in him, then no matter what is coming, God's got it all under control. Listen, we got to keep this thing 100. There have been enough times in my life, I'm not saying your life, I'm only talking about my life, where I've had to forgive people for the pain and the suffering that they've caused. Now see, my flesh don't always want to do that. Y'all's flesh want to do that. My flesh don't want to do that. Because I've seen enough television commercials and heard enough commercials on the radio where they say, you got hurt, you got injured, reach out to us. We going to get you paid. I'm feeling like that when somebody damages me, when I get bruised, that somebody ought to try to compensate me somehow. I mean, somehow I should be compensated because, yeah, right? But not only that, there are times when I've had to encourage people, where God has intentionally sent me to encourage people, and they are the same people who I already know are guilty of creating their own drama. They're guilty of making their own mess. Didn't we see that in the scripture with the two thieves that hung on both sides of Jesus? They created their own drama. He had nothing to do with it, but he offered salvation just the same. But it goes on. There are times when I've had to entrust to someone else that which was dear and ever so precious to me. Times when I felt completely alone and, yes, abandoned. Times when I have been in distress, thirsty, needing a drink of relief, because my own vulnerability with people can leave me and you messed up. Times when I needed to take a deep breath so that I could exhale in victory. But the word of God teaches there's still another word, and that is, Father, into your hands I commit my spirit. You see, Every one of us in Christ Jesus is consecrated for divine assignment. But how do we get there? I'm so glad you asked that too. It's the avenue of submitted obedience. How do we get there? It is the avenue of submitted obedience. Listen, saints, Christ's death is victory for all of humanity. We know that when Christ died, three distinct events happened. The earth shook, the sun refused to shine, and the veil in the temple protecting the holies of holies, where the Ark of the Covenant rested, where only Aaron's high priests were permitted to enter, that same veil was torn, symbolizing all now having access to God. And so, there's still one more thought, which really is the catalyst for all of this in the first place. God, not desiring the sacrifice but obedience, demonstrated to us, using his son Jesus, the depth of his love for us. He demonstrated the significance of obedience through Christ. This signals to us that God's call, God's desire, was solidarity with us choosing to press upward towards the call. In this tearing of the veil, God has taken the first step towards us. Consider a wedding. The bridegroom steps forward to receive the bride. God's actions are bold statements of solidarity, sacred authority, and secured promises. Every time we step into obedience, saints, God reminds us that he has a divine assignment for each one of us, whispering to us, you have been consecrated to do. This is not a feel-good story or a ritualistic celebration. This is about our Almighty God, rich in love, rich in mercy, who calls us to walk through all the other stuff so that we can be in relationship with him. Amen, amen, and amen. God bless you all.
Amen. Father, forgive them. Today you will be with me in paradise. Woman, behold thy son. My God, why hast thou forsaken me? I thirst. It is finished. And Father, into your hands I commit my spirit. Come on, let's give God praise for the word and all the expressions of worship. That God, come on, you can do better than that. Let's give God praise today. And let's give God praise for Jesus. He didn't have to do it, but he did. And he did it for you and he did it for me. Amen. We are coming to the end of our service today. And like I said, Jesus did this for you and he did it for me. And wouldn't it be a shame that he did all of that and we don't accept him? We don't receive his free gift. We don't accept him as our Lord and Savior. So we're going to take just a moment to make sure that everybody knows this God that we were talking about. Everybody here, if you have never received him, this is your opportunity. Those of you that are watching online, you need Jesus. And here's an opportunity for you to receive him for yourself. All you have to do is confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead. We talked about him being on the cross today, but God raised him from the dead. And because of that, he has a name that is above every name, that at every knee is going to bow and every tongue is going to confess that he is Lord. And you can accept him as your Lord today. Hallelujah.
it's good to know that all of us here know the Lord. And we have a relationship with the Lord. Amen. And so as we close out the service, we're going to take up our offering. Amen. It's an opportunity for you to give and to sow into this ministry. And the only thing we ask is that you give unto the Lord with a cheerful heart. Whatever it is that God has placed on your heart to give. And we have several ways that you can give here at the Resurrection Center. One of the ways to give is through text to give. And through your mobile device, you would dial 28950. And once you put that in, you will put in TRC space and whatever amount it is that you're desiring to give. Our ushers are walking through the aisles. If there's anyone here that has a monetary gift or check they want to give, you will make it out to the Resurrection Center. Those of you that are watching online, there's opportunity online for you to give by going to www.trclive.org. Amen. And so when you have your gift, let's raise our gifts. And we're going to pray over our gifts. And we're going to prepare to be dismissed in this place. Everyone, raise your offering. And I'm going to ask if everyone would just follow the dictates of the ushers. We're going to move, walk around and come to the front. We have a basket for you to drop your gift. Amen. Let us look to the Lord. Father, we thank you for this opportunity to give unto you. Thank you for giving us something to give after you have given so much, God. So we come in obedience to your word, God, and we come with a cheerful heart. And we come to sow in good ground. So I pray, God, that you will bless our gifts, that you will multiply it, and that it will be pleasing in your sight. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Follow the dictates of the usher. They're going to lead you from the back.
Oh, the Lamb that was slain, he's alive. Forever he shall reign, he's alive. They crucified him at Calvary, but he rose in victory. Yeah. He's alive. He's alive. He's alive with all power in his hand. He's alive. He's alive. He's alive with all power in his hand. The Lamb that was slain, he's alive. Forever he shall reign, he's alive. They crucified him at Calvary, but he rose in victory. He's alive. He's alive. He's alive with all power in his hand. With all power in his hand. He's alive. He's alive. He's alive. With all power in his hand. He's alive. He's alive. He's alive. With all power.
Thank everyone for coming out today. Before you leave, I want you to know that we have refreshments over in the fellowship hall. So stop over and get something before you leave. And as we prepare for the benediction, our set gifts, our bishop and our pastor is making their way here. We want to have final remarks for them, but can we just put our hands together?
together one more time for our bishop and our pastor who's here with us today.
Hallelujah. Glory be to God. He is wonderful. He is awesome. He is amazing. And he showed himself mighty today through seven vessels. Amen. Who just gave themselves over to him. And so I want to thank each of you for just being available, just being that vessel for him. Amen. That was so wonderful because we are celebrating our Savior. Now, I don't know about y'all, but I woke up this morning and I was like, it's Good Friday. Father, thank you. Thank you. Amen. This is the day that he died. Amen. He was crucified for you and for me. And so I stand here with gratitude. I want to thank each and every one of you, those of you who are here, those of you who are online, who have been praying for me, who have sent me cards, who have sent me texts, who have called me. Thank you so much for your expressions of care and love. It was needed and appreciated. Amen. And God heard you. Amen. God heard you. So thank you so much. And I am so glad to see all of you. I'm so delighted. And so I just couldn't stop smiling. I'm just so excited to be here with you all. And I've never stopped doing life with you. Amen. I'm still doing life with you. I just had to take a little sabbatical, but I'm here and I bless the Lord. Amen. So good to see you. Amen. And it's so good to see the Douglases. Amen. Love you guys.
Amen. I'm not going to hold us. I want to echo appreciation for your prayers. And without a doubt, I want to make reference to all seven of the words this night and the past four messages. Amen. The past 2 weeks as we've celebrated Women's Month. For Cleo and I, it's 40 years for me in the Lord. 34 years of marriage, 35 in September. Amen.
You see how she...
I think he likes me. I don't know. 35 years.
24 here at Resurrection. And as I sat there tonight, it's much more than a word for me. It's watching the lives of people, the service, the sacrifice, the cost and the joy. And in life, I thought about a few things that were said. First of all, he breathed his last. Each of us will breathe our last. And I think about the fact that he can look over his shoulder. Jesus can look over his shoulder at his finished work and look at how we're still being blessed today. And so as I think about serving the Lord and the journey of 40 years, tonight just blessed me to see the fruit of the labor, to see the personalities that have been dipped in Jesus Christ. Amen. Powerful expressions, rich stories, because life is hard, guys. Life is a challenge. And so I just want to encourage you. I want to encourage you to pray. And please know, many of you may be wondering, I've also been on a mission. I've been spending a few days in New York every week since September, and I've been writing a musical. It's a musical that celebrates the August Quarterly. And every week I've had to make presentations in front of those who, just today we met the writer of the play Memphis. And so it's a different caliber that I've been challenged to stand before. Totally intimidated, totally out of my comfort zone. But I'm here to say at this point we have an hour and 30 minutes of what is quite a phenomenal musical. It still needs rewrite. It still needs a lot of work. And then we have to bring it to Delaware. The intention is to deposit into the history of our state something that could be a significant storytell. Celebrates our culture, our history. And a day of celebration, the August Quarterly, was initiated in 1814, and it is celebrated to this day in Wilmington, Delaware. And it was founded by a black man, Peter Spencer, freed at age 17 and came to Delaware. So I appreciate your prayers, and we want you to know we love you. And thank you so much, Pastor Tamika, for your leadership, and to our pastoral staff, our volunteer pastors. I'll close with this. The reason I saw when the dancers were praising and the culminating expression was the wind, the movement of the Spirit of God. This church has been favored by God for 132 years. There's no such thing as a perfect church. And I think it's been stated tonight that there's no such thing as a perfect person. Amen. All of us, by the grace of God, are on the same journey. And so I just want to encourage you. Know that we stand on good ground and God is not through. He's setting the stage for the next generations of success and generosity. Amen. Amen. All right, so we're standing together. We want to close with prayer. How about we join hands across the aisles? Amen. Amen. Tonight's seven last words, I want to add one simple point. As we've gone through all the expressions of Christ from his statements, his last statements on Calvary, what we are ultimately presented with is the surrender of the Son of God to the Father. And if there's one summation that I would present to all of us, it is that his model of surrender is eternally successful. And I would encourage you to surrender your life as well. Whether you're on a cross or whether you're on a cruise, surrender. Amen to our Heavenly Father. Let's pray. Father, we love you. We draw near. We thank you. We bless you. You've done so much, brought us so far. And tonight we've had deposits made once again in our spirit. And so I pray that you bless those who dug into the scriptures, presented themselves a living sacrifice, made themselves available to then make a deposit in our lives. And Father, all the words that we've heard, to every ear that has listened and every heart that has received, I pray you plant the seeds and bring forth good fruit and cause that fruit to last. In Jesus' name, let every heart say amen. 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 I'll see y'all on Easter Sunday morning. God bless you.